A man impaled after falling from scaffolding dies from his injuries. A local lab, now a World Health Organization National Influenza Center. Judicial administrative anomalies highlighted by the outgoing Chief Justice. And in sports, Barbados is on schedule to complete preparations for the 2024 Cricket World Cup.
Broadcasting from our studios in the Pine St. Michael, this is CBC NewsNight, starting now.
Good evening, I'm Pearson Bowie. A construction worker lost his life today after falling from scaffolding and being impaled on a piece of steel. It happened on the compound of this upscale development. The Barbados Police Service, in a statement, says the incident took place at a building at Lot C4, Apes Hill, St. James, around 8:20 this morning. Reports are that the deceased, a 51-year-old Guyanese national and resident of Barbados, was one of two men who fall from the scaffolding, which was said to be approximately 30 to 40 feet high. He died on the spot. The other man, who complained of pain to his back and lower extremities, was taken to hospital via ambulance. Police investigations are continuing. The Best Dos Santos Laboratory is now a World Health Organization National Influenza Center. The local laboratory joins the likes of the Caribbean Public Health Agency and a virology lab at the University of the West Indies. Andrew Lowe has more on that story.
Last September, Barbados underwent an assessment for the designation of a World Health Organization National Influenza Center. It successfully completed the process, which means it can now undertake specialized diagnostics, contribute to global flu surveillance, and provide critical data in the fight against influenza and pandemics. At a special ceremony to recognize the achievement, Prime Minister Mia Moore-Motley said Barbados has shown it is possible to reach global excellence.
To have this designation by the World Health Organization says to the rest of the world that this lab has reached these standards and is capable of being trusted. And that's the most important word in here. And therefore, for us to have a lab that can be truly trusted with respect to its results, it doesn't mean that there's always perfection, but it means that the systems and the processes are those that are worthy of trust, and that if something goes wrong, that we can easily and quickly determine what has happened in order to get back on the straight and narrow path.
Prime Minister Motley also pointed out that Barbados has been synonymous with excellence in the journey of public health improvement in the Caribbean and the Americas over the last century. I would want to continue to assert itself in that regard. But she says Barbados cannot continue to make investments and not create avenues of enterprise for its citizens.
This country cannot continue to invest as we are doing millions and hundreds of millions of dollars in ensuring that our citizens can be the best that they can be by studying at the University of the West Indies, and then not have opportunities for them to remain in the land of their birth or the land that they choose to really want to live in simply because we do not have the opportunities for them to work.
Director of the Best Dos Santos Lab, the Most Honorable Dr. Sonji Beckles, says the journey to this designation started in 2008 following an amalgamation of three local labs.
Based on what we want to achieve, become the National Influenza Center, it's definitely on the horizon. We can definitely do this. We went back and we looked to see what we had documented, review what the requirements were from WHO, and we said, okay, let's make sure that we have everything in place. We had our assessment in September of 2023, and the official notification coming back to the ministry saying stamp of approval. We saw it in February of this year. And we were so excited. And everybody started to scream. And I told them we got it. And we were so excited. So we were really, really happy.
Dr. Beckles is ecstatic about the achievement and all that her team has accomplished. She's confident of furthering the lab's overall capacity after playing a critical role in the national fight against COVID-19, with over 800,000 tests being processed. Andrew Lowe, CBC News.
Outgoing Chief Justice Sir Patterson Cheltenham wants discrepancies at the administrative level of the judicial system fixed. He says he inherited this historical anomaly needs to be addressed to allow for improvements in the judicial system. Sir Patterson adds that his call is important at this time when Barbados is in the midst of profound constitutional changes. Trevor Thorpe has that story.
It was while addressing the opening ceremony of the Latimer House Principles Symposium that Chief Justice Sir Patterson Cheltenham identified a number of concerns. He is completely opposed, for example, to the President of Barbados having to give the green light for a member of the judiciary to go on temporary leave. Sir Patterson said this historical anomaly makes absolutely no sense, since the Chief Justice, who is head of the judiciary, is in a better position to make such a major decision that would impact the operations of the judicial system.
I think it is wrong, fundamentally wrong. The executive has no right saying to a Chief Justice, whoever he or she may be, that I will say that leave is to be granted to X or to Y, or on what terms and conditions. That is one of the things we have inherited. And I also recall when I first took up the job that my executive assistant used to say to me, oh, you have to write to the cabinet for when you are going overseas. I said, let me share something with you, ma'am. I did not take up this job to forfeit my freedom. However, as Chief Justice, I will duly inform them of my absence from the island, because that carries implications. There will be a need to have someone in office whilst I'm away. But I am not seeking cabinet's approval for my flights.
He also noted potential issues with judges having reached the age of retirement needing to apply to the executive for an extension.
That is a request that ought to be made to whoever is the incumbent Chief Justice. He looks at the docket. You talk with the judge about how that person is feeling, how is your health, you think you can do an extra 2 years, or do you want at most 18 months? That is the type of intimate, personal, but also a very professional dialogue you will have. You send that to the executive. And what then happens? You are in a civil matter dealing with constitutional issues, and you have to be contemplating, how do I go? No judge should be doing this. Do I go left? Do I go right? If I go left, maybe I'll get the extension. If I go right, they may be angry with me.
Additionally, Sir Patterson said his office was also lacking administrative office essentials because the budget for the registration department is controlled by the Attorney General.
So technically, a Chief Justice could say, well, it's your bailiwick. It's nothing to do with me. And if it falls, if it stands, it's at you. I don't take that approach. I think as a Chief Justice, you have to be responsible. And you have to be concerned about how the registration department functions, because it is the engine room. If you're the pilot, you have to be sure that the engines are working well. But it's a matter in which I have no say.
The symposium will expose members of the judiciary to the Latimer House Principles Toolkit, which provides a practical guide to enhancing the separation of powers. The Chief Justice is hoping for positive suggestions to come out of the robust discussions that will redound to the improved judiciary. The event, being held at the Lloyd Erskine Sandford Center, has been organized by the Commonwealth Secretariat. Trevor Thorpe, CBC News.
One family is now homeless and others displaced at Sealy Land after a fire last night. Wendy Burt tells us their house was destroyed and others damaged.
This blaze is what caused the destruction of one timber house, extensively damaged another, and slightly damaged one more at Sealy Land Bank Hall, St. Michael. Officials from the Barbados Fire Service say the fire, which occurred around 8:24 last night, left seven people displaced. They told CBC News the first wooden house, which was completely gutted, was occupied by two people. A second timber house was occupied by four people, while one person resided at the other property. No injuries were reported, and two water appliances and 10 fire officers under the command of Divisional Fire Officer Marlon Spall responded to the blaze. Dio Small told CBC it was a challenging fire to bring under control because access to the area was hampered due to the indiscriminate parking of cars on the narrow street. It also created issues in accessing the fire hydrant. Small is pleading with individuals to park in a more orderly fashion, or on realizing there's an emergency in the neighborhood to hurriedly move the vehicles. Wendy Burke, CBC News.
We'll take a break here, but coming up, a call for the road leading to Fall Bay Beach to be repaired. Minister of Agriculture, Food and Nutritional Security Indar Weir has sought to ensure attention is paid by government to the Fall Bay Beach Road in St. Philip. The Member of Parliament for St. Philip South made this known while speaking to residents during a Meet the People session at the Crane Nazarene Church, where he provided a progress report. He said with the introduction of Wyndham Samlord's Castle and the presence of Crane Hotel, villas and Airbnb properties, Fall Bay Beach is heavily utilized. Mr. Weir therefore sees the road leading to it as important to the image of Barbados and has had conversations with the Minister of Transport and Works about its upkeep.
I was upfront with the minister when I told her, inasmuch as people don't live down there, people go down there. They go for picnics, they go for recreation. Visitors to this island will go there to experience the history of Fall Bay, and there's a full documentary on the history of Fall Bay that anybody can see. It ran as a series on CBC TV. Our Fisher Folk would use Fall Bay Beach Road as well. A lot of our people who go walking use Fall Bay Beach, they use the stairs. So I gave all the reasons why we should use Fall Bay Beach and why the road should be repaired. And that is coming.
Since establishing the Ministry of Industry, Innovation, Science and Technology, Barbados is still seeking to recruit the right mix of personnel to fill critical vacant posts. This was revealed by Permanent Secretary in the Ministry, Marva Howell. She was participating in the fourth meeting of the Economic Cooperation on Latin America and the Caribbean Conference on Science, Innovation and ICT in Colombia.
Acknowledging the aging population and skills deficit in the areas of science and technology, where possible, we have sought to contract professionals from other countries who have the expertise and experience to fill vacancies and to work with locals with the intention of transferring skills and knowledge through training, coaching, and mentoring.
Well, moved by the response to last year's edition of the UWI RBC Run for the Kids, the first since the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic, the organizers are looking to build on it and are anticipating greater participation. Well, this year is the eighth edition of the race, which is slated for this coming Sunday. The RBC Race for the Kids started with an inaugural event in New York City. It is now a compelling series of global charitable races supporting children's causes. Managing Director of RBC Royal Bank Barbados, Shimon McIntosh, says the bank, through its partnership with the University of the West Indies at Cave Hill, has been supporting youth and education in Barbados. He was a guest on Morning Barbados.
The Race for the Kids has always been about uplifting others, creating opportunities for youth, and opening doors for the future. And in keeping with that purpose, we are proud in Barbados to support youth and education. And we have our valued partnership with the University of the West Indies Cave Hill campus. And we support the UWI Cave Hill campus by providing scholarships and also funding to the first year experience program.
The Boys Scouts Association of Barbados is aiming to increase its membership after a significant drop during the COVID-19 pandemic. They've been trying various ways to boost numbers and the interest of children in becoming scouts. The Scouts Association held its second annual Fun Day in Queen's Park, which attracted more than 500 people. Chairman of the Fun Day Committee, Jason King, says there are some other things in place to attract both youth and adults.
There are a few new beaver colonies that are coming into being. And once the boys are in beavers and are attracted to the program, we then move them on to cubs. There are also some schools and groups that don't have a beaver section, and they only start at cubs. We've been making sure now that once they reach that cub section, which is 7 to 10 and a half/11 years old, that there's a scout group that they can go to. They may not be a scout group as part of scout troop as part of their particular group, but we're trying to partner certain or channel certain kapats to have their boys go to certain troops.
Sports Night is brought to you by Power In. Pause is power. And by Dasani. Live first, Dasani after.
Well, we're back, and it's time now to go over to Anne-Marie Burke. Good evening, Anne-Marie.
Good evening to you, Pearson, and I'll start with news of cricket. With 54 days to go before the start of the men's ICC T20 Cricket World Cup in the United States and here in the Caribbean, officials are reporting steady progress in preparation for the highly anticipated tournament set to begin on June the 1st. This morning, Cricket West Indies provided an update. CBC's Anne-Marie Goodrich-Boyce reports.
Cricket West Indies President Dr. Kishore Shallow says Barbados is well ahead of the other Caribbean nations in terms of completing work on the island at the historic Kensington Oval for the upcoming ICC T20 Cricket World Cup. Speaking during a media conference this morning at the Lloyd Erskine Sandiford Centre, Dr. Shallow indicated that an ongoing inspection is suggesting that Barbados is on schedule to deliver a high-class tournament with 9 matches, including the final, set for the region's Mecca. Dr. Shallow also said that there is a high demand for tickets with the expectancy of full venues as physical box offices will be open from April 24th.
So far, the uptake of ticket sales is positive as well. It shows that at this point, it indicates that we are going to have, you know, at least the top games are going to be sold out right across the region. A few of the matches are already sold out.
Chairman of the National Organizing Committee, Ambassador Noah Lynch, says more than 2,000 Barbadians have already bought tickets, and those who haven't as yet should not be disadvantaged.
People in Barbados know about cricket, and they should not be disadvantaged in terms of coming into the stadium. So therefore, the ticket situation is one that must be fixed. Barbadians are, as you said, we understand manual box offices. The fella that ain't got no smartphone is aged out or timed out or scienced out or technologically out must still believe that he or she has access to Kensington Oval to watch these matches. If you go down to the park, to Empire Club or to St. Catherine or YMPC to watch cricket on a Saturday, you must feel that you can get into the stadium to watch the World Cup. It's our World Cup in our backyard.
Lynch also stated that an ICC T20 Cricket World Cup app will be launched shortly, where fans can access all the information they need for the cricket spectacle. Anne-Marie Goodrich-Boyce, CBC Sports.
Veteran administrator Randy Harris was returned to the helm of local football last night when the Barbados Football Association held its annual general meeting and congress at the Wildy Turf. Harris, the incumbent, scored 7 more votes than his challenger, former national goalkeeper Omari Eastman, to narrowly secure his 4th consecutive term as BFA president with a 37-30 victory. Following a 3.5-hour-long tension-filled meeting, Harris emerged as the winner just before 8 p.m.
I put myself in the race because I want to complete my mission of developing, first of all, the facility, and then looking at getting serious about programs, mostly junior programs, because we have to look to the future of football in Barbados. I want to thank the members for having confidence in me again, and I just want to say to the challenger, he put up a good fight, and I think he has something to give to football, and I hope that this loss won't cause him, you know, to feel that he's not welcome to assist.
Who also serves as president of the Caribbean Football Union and who's also the CONCACAF vice president, outlined his vision for the future and hinted at the 2024 to 2028 term being his last.
I start this presidency to ensure that Barbados has its own facility. Football will never improve if we don't have proper facilities. Anybody would tell you that. So my mission, and I think this will be my last term, is to make sure that our technical center here is completed.
In other BFA election results, Chief Executive Officer at the Transport Board Fabian Wharton, Captain Al Walcott and Ashton Chapman total 40, 24 and 17 votes respectively to be elected as Vice Presidents. Tracia Ford, Ren Ramsey, Simon Alsop, O'Brien Smith and Shamika Eswick will serve as Executive Board Members.
The Business Report is brought to you with the kind compliments of the National Insurance and Social Security Service. More than a contribution, it's your lifeline.
In business tonight, complaints against Barbados mobile telecommunications providers are rising. The Fair Trading Commission is reporting it has been receiving a lot of complaints attributed to mobile telecommunications sector. Statistics provided by Director of Consumer Protection, Dava Leslie Ward, show that during the period 2013 to 2015, 24 complaints were made. This, however, moved to 86 during 2016 to 2019. Among the issues identified, consumers unable to keep up with data notifications. Ms. Leslie Ward was among the guests for The People's Business, where the topic, the Mobile Telecommunications Code, was discussed.
They had no idea that they could even set their phones to notify them. So we had a lot of cases of persons who had excessive charges. Persons were complaining that they did not understand the terms and conditions. Or some people are saying, well, I signed up for this plan so long ago, I really don't even know what it is about. We had problems related to even getting through to the company in terms of having complaints being heard. So all of these things, that is what I can tell you. That's why we tracked the entire consumer journey, because we wanted to make sure that all of the complaints that we received, it tracked each point of that journey, and that is why we did that.
Ms. Leslie Ward says the FTC has been assessing the time limits offered by service providers following mobile top-ups.
It's an issue that we did look into a little while ago. So internationally, there are usually limits on when and the length of time in which you can actually top up your phone. So what we would advise consumers from time to time, especially those older consumers, if you know that you don't make a lot of calls, keep your top ups to a minimum. Now, I understand how persons feel, but what we have asked the service providers to do is to provide a date when you top up so that you know when that amount is about to expire. So what we're asking the consumers to do is also to exercise some responsibility, because we know that with rights, you also have responsibilities, and make a note for yourself.
Ferro cement technology could be part of the solution to the water problems faced by farmers. This from National Program Technician at the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture, Damien Hines. He made the disclosure while discussing the development of projects between the Ministry of Agriculture, Food and Nutritional Security and ICA. Ferro cement tanks are built by hand, troweling layers of cement mortar onto a wire frame. According to Mr. Hines, this can be used by farmers to build water storage tanks to alleviate the problems that they face.
Our program looks at this issue in a number of different ways. One, in looking at the whole issue of water, we recognize that given our water scarcity, we have to ensure that we have a reliable, safe supply of water for farming throughout the year. So one of the programs that we have been working on in the past, Minister, is the introduction of ferrocement technologies. And this is something that we think could prove very critical to our water, solution for farmers in Barbados.
Time for us to get back to sports. Time for us to get back to Anne-Marie Burke. Anne-Marie.
Yes, Pearson, they start with basketball this time around. In just their first year after acquiring new talent in the offseason, Cam Smart Assurance City United Celtics are into the final of the Cooperators General Insurance Barbados Amateur Basketball Association's Premier League. They knocked off defending champions Pioneers in their semifinal playoff series last night at the Barbados Community College. CBC's Mark Seal was there.
Despite being outmanned and outgunned, Pylon still got the ball rolling. The very first play of the game, and Rashad Hall knocks down the contested jumper. Good for three. But that 3-love early advantage would be their biggest lead of the game. Kadeem Brathwaite with the turnover and Joel Hunt with the Euro step. He gets Celtics on the scoreboard. Hunt, incidentally, had a big game for Celtics. He went to the free throw line a game-high 11 times and also posted a double-double, 18 rebounds and a game-high 28 points, two of them coming on this individual effort. Knowing Pylons had a very small bench, Celtics were forcing the pace. Here, Theo Greenidge gets the steal, and some quick passes allows Tyrone King to get an open three. He had 11. Anand Joseph Thorne making sure there's no rest for the Pine while they're on defense. He draws the attention and finds Greenidge for 3 of his 16. Three of Pineland's players were called on by the coach to do the bulk of the work. Darian Hurley played all but 17 seconds of the entire game and posted a team-high 25 points and 12 boards. Rashid Maynard played all but 50 seconds, and he had a double-double as well, 22 points and 14 rebounds, while Hall played all but 32 seconds, 15 boards and 23 points, three of them here. Still though, Celtics led by as many as 14 in the first half and were up by 12 points at the half, 54 to 42. After the 10-minute halftime break, Pylons dialed up the defense and went on an 11-point run, reducing the deficit from 12 to just 1, 57 to 58. Maynard with the big block on Greenidge. Celtics would eventually respond. Thorne, with his ability to get to the hole, had the defender on his heels, and this allows for the straight-on three that rattles home. Thorne had 3 threes in his 21-point performance. With Celtics keeping the intensity up to put the game out of the reach of the defending champs, high-quality defending was out the window. The Celtics won the game 90-81 and the series 2-1, booking a place in the best-of-5 final series against Burger King Clapper Bowls. The dates, times, and venues are yet to be announced. Mark Seal, CBC Sports.
The Barbados Amateur Gymnastics Association hosted its Trident Classic over the weekend at the Worldy Gym, featuring young gymnasts from across the region and here in Barbados. When CBC Sports visited the gym, the all-round competition was in full swing. And they say the little one shall lead them, and that's just what Trinidad and Tobago's Kanaya Jones did, as she was best among the girls in Group 1 of Level 3 gymnasts. After posting scores of 9.4 on vault, 9.15 on bars, and 8.925 on the beam, it was a floor exercise scene here where she gained her highest score, a 9.475, to be the champion. We also caught Group 1 of the Level 4s on the floor routine, where it was another TNT domination. This is Onaya Hepburn, who came into this final rotation sitting in second, and she showed skill and precision in her presentation, hoping for a good score to take the win. In the end, she was given a 9.1 for a total of a 35.825, and second is the place she would maintain. As it was her teammate, Asia Ali, who has scores of 9 on the vault, 8.85 on the bars, and 9.050 on the beam, that not only came in as a leader, but was best on the floor. She had flair, precision, and here she goes with an effective triple tumble to gain a 9.175 and an overall 36.075 to win that division. Two girls competed in Group 2 of Level 4, both Barbadian, and it was on the balance beam that we picked up their rotation. This is Paige Brooker, who took great pains to keep her balance and get a good score. Actually, it was on this apparatus that she gained her highest score, an 8.8, and we can see she handled it well. But our winner was Amber Haynes, although it was on the beam where she encountered her biggest challenge, falling twice. But regaining her composure, she was able to gain a 7.825 to add to her 9.3 on the vault, a 9.075 on the bars, and a 9.2 on the floor, for an overall score of 35.4 to win Group 2 of Level 4. Meanwhile, on the uneven bars, Zuri caught Group 2 of Level 6. And this is Barbadian Jazara Levine going through her routine. She actually ended second overall in this division, gaining an 8.5 on the bars. And might I add, that was a perfect landing. Finishing in third was Daniela Small, who here on the bars had a 7.625, but overall posted 35.325. That division was won by another Barbadian, Serena Walcott-Lloyd. All in all, it was a great display of skill by some of the region's young gymnasts.
Well, if you were wondering why today we were not able to see that total eclipse of the sun, well, we were just too far south. Here's what happened. Those in Mexico have already seen the effects, and also parts of the United States like Atlanta, New York, Texas, and Canada. Some Barbadians also sent us images which make the sun appear like an orange ball, like from Lawrenceville, Atlanta. Astrology enthusiast and former president of the Barbados Astronomical Society, Ricardo Small, explained that Barbados is 1,500 miles south of the path, so we were not able to see anything here.
Move across the Earth's surface, okay? So anyone within the track of the moon's shadow will see the eclipse. So if you are direct, if the moon passes directly over your location, you will see an total eclipse of the sun.
Mr. Small spoke to the regions which were able to see the celestial spectacle.
Occasion, the moon's shadow basically passed through western Mexico, turned a little bit to the north, passed through northern northern Florida, and right up the northern the eastern seaboard of the United States. So everyone on the eastern seaboard of the United States, so right up through U.S. into Canada, would have seen a total eclipse of the sun.
Well, speaking of Canada, two Canadian visitors, Derek and Andy Ho, who are here in Barbados, did not regret missing it because they're happier to be seeing the sea, sun, and sand.
Not really. Like, I mean, you can't look at it straight on anyway. You've got to wear special glasses to watch it. And we're from Nova Scotia, Canada. And I think it's one of the places in Canada where you get a really good view of it. But missing it? No. Not really.
Oh, not really. No. I'd rather be here. Yeah.
With the sun as opposed to the eclipse.
Yeah, well. So, yeah, it's all good.
Well, that's our time tonight. Thank you for spending it with us. I'm Pearson Bowen. For the crew, to all of you, good night. By God's will, we'll see you tomorrow.